The Earth has a life cycle all of its own. Its rocks are born, grow older, and die, to be reborn in the molten heart of our planet. Landslides are just part of this endless natural process. Unfortunately for us, we humans sometimes get caught in the way. The ground beneath our feet is not always as solid and secure as it may seem. And landslides are one of the ways that nature constantly refashions the Earth. It's a totally natural process. But landslides can kill and injure thousands of people. Scientists test out ways to protect us, but keeping us safe in this ever-shifting world means understanding what causes landslides. Geologists say the answer is complex. It's partly the way that nature creates the rocks of our planet, like here on Hawaii, where in just over 20 years, lava flows have built up 60 feet of rock. It's partly the destructive force of water, and partly the power of gravity. Landslides are a vital part of what scientists call the rock cycle. It starts with magma, molten rock within the crust of the Earth. Magma that can push up through cracks in the Earth's surface to form hills and mountains. These weather back down again, washed away through streams and rivers, down to the sea, where the crushing weight of tectonic plates colliding forces it back underground to remelt into magma. Every landslide has a unique combination of causes, each a fascinating detective mystery. Not so much a whodunit, as a why did this one happen here? One place where landslides happen quite literally all of the time is here, on the coast of Southern California. These hills constantly slip-slide away toward the Pacific Ocean. Pale landslide scars disfigure every hillside here in La Conchita. So many landslides happen here because these coastal hills are made of very weak sedimentary rock. This sedimentary rock was created under the sea. That undersea process is part of the rock cycle. As mountains are weathered down by wind and rain, they ever so slowly crumble to pieces, which wash down to the sea, to be crushed on the seabed as layer upon layer builds up above them. And natural minerals precipitate out from the water, cementing them over hundreds of thousands of years into hard, well-formed rock. But sometimes, this part of the rock cycle is interrupted. Earthquakes can push ill-formed sedimentary rocks up out of the water to form hills, as here on the California coast. It's a premature birth with dramatic consequences. Geologist Randy Jibson doesn't think much of these rocks.
They're very weak, they're not well cemented, and they're simply falling down around themselves. This material is melting like warm butter.
Despite the danger, these butter mountains are prime real estate country. An oceanside location to die for. And tragically, Dying is just what people did in the landslide-prone California town of La Conchita, 70 miles northwest of Los Angeles. The inherent weakness of the rock was one obvious cause of the tragedy that struck here on January 10th, 2005. But not the only cause. In the early days of the year, rain, and yet more rain had fallen along the California coastline. As storms brought the near-record rainfall, landslide after landslide blocked the coastal highway. ...33-year-old waitress Isabel Vasquez was staying at the home of her friend, Vanessa Bryson. Isabel planned to go home to L.A., but decided to wait out the storm. It would be a while. She left her friend in the front room and walked to a rear bedroom. Unbeknown to Isabel, she was in deadly danger. La Conchita lies at the foot of unstable hills, and hurtling towards the town was this 250,000 cubic yards landslide. The house started shaking.
I felt the tremble, the rumbling right through my body.
Seconds later, the landslide, flowing faster than most people can run, plowed into the town. It crushed 30 homes in its path, burying Isabel and her friend deep under the wreckage. Isabel was kept alive by a cabinet falling across her, holding her down, but leaving space for her to breathe.
I'm stuck. I'm pinned. I thought that this was it. I was gonna die.
She was helpless, terrified, and unable to move. All Isabel could do was scream for help.
I thought that the mud was gonna come and bury me.
But then, Isabel got lucky. Her cries were heard by survivors up above. And they alerted the Ventura County Fire Department. Firefighter Garrett Prater was on the scene within minutes, digging down toward the trapped woman.
She's right here on all fours, and she was pinned, you know, basically all her entire back. Her left leg, her foot was actually up at her neck.
Isabel was crying in agony. The landslide site was dangerous and highly unstable. Prater had to act quickly, even though he had no other firemen with him to ensure his own safety.
I basically took a chainsaw, so I was able to cut through a lot of large debris.
He just tore it apart. Like, I could not. So fast, and he grabbed me underneath my arms and just lifted me up.
Isabel recovered from her injuries, and Prater received a bravery award.
It wasn't an act of bravery. A lot of people have said, you know, I was very brave, but it really wasn't. It was just, it's what we're trained to do, and it's kind of one of those things that any fireman that would have been in my situation, I know would have done the same thing that I did.
The La Conchita slide moved so rapidly that it killed 10 people, including Isabel's closest friend, Vanessa Bryson. Previous landslides here were slow-moving and easy to escape. So why did this one rush so rapidly downhill? Geologist Randy Jibson tried to solve that riddle.
About 500,000 tons of material took off and came straight down the slope. Part of it overtopped this wall here. You can see these massive I-beams. They're really huge, and yet they were pushed over just like toothpicks. And then it swept around in this other direction where it pushed about 36 houses, one just into another.
Jibson faced a particular mystery. He knew the slide came after days of heavy rain. So why was the landslide debris so dry?
We expected to find a soupy, muddy mess. In fact, much of the material that we saw in the January landslide was relatively dry.
How did rock and earth do so much damage when so little water was found here? The hillside was far too unstable to climb, and to solve the water mystery, Jibson needed a closer look.
This might look like a fairly small landslide, but it really devastated this neighborhood.
Jibson's helicopter eye view revealed the full pattern of the debris flow, giving him an insight into how the slide moved.
It mobilized and became kind of like a liquid. You can see the water coming out of the slope in a variety of places that's draining.
Seeing several streams of water draining from deep in the hillside gave Jibson the vital clue as to why this landslide traveled so quickly into the town of La Conchita.
And the materials in these hillsides along the ocean here.
Many people might not realize it, but slopes have plumbing systems just like a house has a plumbing system. Every slope has fractures in it, and the fractures conduct water just like a pipe conducts water through the walls of a house.
Part of this slope's plumbing system is an earthquake fault running into the hill.
When a fault moves in a hillside like this one, it grinds the material in the hillside very, very fine. It's called fault gouge. It prohibits water from percolating through it. It's just like a grout in your bathtub that's made to stop water. And when this water comes percolating down, it reaches this layer that's just like that bathtub grout, and it can't get past it.
Water had been soaking into this hillside for days. Jibson explains how water causes a landslide.
There are two big myths about what water does to landslides. The first myth is that the water lubricates the slope somehow. The second myth is that the water makes the hillside too heavy to hold up its own weight. Well, it's not about weight and it's not about lubrication, it's about pressure. A pickle jar full of golf balls really is a very good analogy.
Jibson's golf balls represent separate particles of soil, touching, but with spaces in between. Water fills up those spaces, just as it does in a saturated hill. Rain soaks through the top layer, leaving it relatively dry, but saturates the layers below. Deep in the hill, the weight of the water above increases the pressure. Just like diving in the ocean, the deeper you go, the greater the pressure you feel on your lungs and ears. In our mountainside, the water pressure is greatest deep down along the impermeable fault line. Here, that high pressure water forces its way in between every individual particle of soil. The water separates the particles, which lessens the friction between them and makes it easier for them to slide apart from each other. What had been a solid mass, rigidly locked together by the friction between its particles, becomes a weak and only loosely consolidated layer. This weakening of the friction that binds the soil together greatly increases the risk of a landslide.
There was muddy, weak, wet material there. And that material mobilized and liquefied, and on top of it was riding a layer of this dry, dusty, dirty material. It was very much like just having a battering ram on a layer of ball bearings that was rolled rapidly into this neighborhood.
Jibson's forensic detective investigation helped to solve the mystery of why the La Conchita slide killed so many people. It was deadly because it moves so rapidly. Because the top dry battering ram of rock slid on a hidden layer of slippery wet mud. Because putty-like fault gouge blocked up the pipes. And water pressure built up in a slope formed from weak, prematurely pushed up rock. As the greatest ever detective might say, it's sedimentary, Dr. Watson. Not all landslides really slide. Scientists call them mass-wasting events, and they come in three main flavors. Slides, falls or flows, depending on the way they move down a slope. La Conchita, for example, started out as a slide type of landslide, one single cohesive mass sliding down slope. But then the large lumps broke up and it turned into a flow landslide, small particles running individually downhill like a liquid. And then there is the third type of landslide, a rockfall. A rockfall in 1996 brought death and destruction to Yosemite National Park in Northern California. 80,000 tons of solid rock, free-falling more than 1,000 feet at more than a third of the speed of sound. Naked Science is following the geology detectives, investigating how landslides happen. So far, we've seen how slides happen in weak sedimentary rock. You don't find rock like that here, in California's Yosemite National Park. These towering granite cliffs are the tough guys on the block. They're made from hard, strong rock, born from magma that slowly cooled underground. Yet gravity finally defeats even rocks this tough, spawning the somewhat obviously named fall type of landslide. July 10th, 1996, 6:52 p.m., near Glacier Point, Yosemite National Park. Two massive boulders, together weighing 80,000 tons, as much as a U.S. Navy aircraft carrier, split from the cliff face and plunged in ballistic freefall 2,400 feet to the valley floor. Choking rock dust spread out across the forest. Park Ranger Gary Ingram was on duty nearby.
It looked like a bomb had gone off. There were tens of dozens of trees that were blown over. I was terrified coming in here. Your initial reaction is just to flee like everybody else that had been in this area.
I couldn't see out the front of my windshield. There was so much dust. You could see people coming down the road that looked like ghosts. Many of them were in a panic. They were trying to keep the dust out of their eyes. They were covering their mouth and nose to breathe. I had three grown men jump into the back of my patrol car screaming. They were so afraid.
Others rushed to help, including fellow ranger Scott Gedeman.
We still had rocks coming down, people looking for loved ones. It was a chaotic scene. And then, of course, we had to dig people out.
At the nearby, now ironically named Happy Isles Nature Center, one man died and a woman was paralyzed. Both were crushed under trees. Even years later, the forest still bears the scars. But how does tough granite break off so easily? Heat expansion and cold contraction open up cracks. Roots force their way in. Water freezes solid and expands to prise the rocks open. The geologists call it frost wedging. They know why granite cracks, but the mechanics of the Happy Isles rockfall still puzzle those who were there. The mystery is that although two huge boulders fell, neither did any direct damage. They shattered on the rock slope without touching any of the trees. Yet hundreds of those trees were inexplicably flattened, leaving a wake of death and destruction.
After the rockfall, a geologist came up and answered some of our questions. And one of the questions were, how did those trees fall over? And he basically took cards and he set them up something like this. And he took a book and he said that there's a body of air in front of these rocks that were coming down.
And he just let the book fall down flat. and it blew every card off the table. And basically when the rocks came down, they were pushing tremendous amounts of wind. And like that book, the force of wind knocked all the trees over.
The two giant rocks impacted at 260 miles per hour. Air then blasted outwards from the impact point at 174 miles per hour, a wind force equal to the most severe Category 5 hurricane. The air blast blew 1,000 trees away. Rock falls have always been a danger here. Almost a third of Yosemite's 100 miles of roads and trails have long been classified as rockfall hazard areas. The only certain way of avoiding rockfalls is never to go near the mountains at all. But few people would ever heed such advice.
The scenic splendor of a place like Yosemite attracts people by the millions. And when we have large numbers of people in close proximity with a natural but very, very dangerous physical process, then sometimes tragedies will occur.
Nature's power can be cruel, as it was when an Australian landslide buried one man alive in a flooded underground concrete tomb. For days, nobody heard his frantic cries for help. New South Wales, Australia. The Snowy Mountain Range, 260 miles south of Sydney, home to the tiny ski resort village of Thredbo. On the night of July 30th, 1997, this hillside started to move. At first, a few inches, then a few feet, before becoming an unstoppable torrent, racing downhill more than 70,000 cubic feet of earth. 3,800 tons of soaking wet mud and rock broke loose and hurtled down the mountainside, crushing two ski lodges and burying 19 people before sliding to a halt on a precarious 40-degree slope. The riddle of what set this landslide in motion led to one of the most lengthy and complex landslide investigations ever mounted. In the aftermath of the slide, emergency calls for help poured into the fire service headquarters.
Fire brigade, how can I help? What, you're in a building, the building's collapsed, has it? Or multiple buildings collapsed? Okay, whereabouts? Yeah, okay, no, I've already got someone on the way right now.
We'll be there shortly.
Yeah, do you have any idea how many people we might have trapped or how many buildings down?
The local part-time fire brigade rushed to the scene, discovering with horror that many of their own relatives, friends, and neighbors had been buried alive. Those missing included ski instructor Stuart Diver and his wife Sal. They had been asleep in their apartment when the speed and weight of the landslide pushed the ski lodge off its foundations, crushing it nearly flat and burying the recently wed couple deep under the wreckage. Stuart and Sal were both pinned down by concrete slabs and soaked in icy water, which flooded down the hillside as the land slid. They screamed as water rose over their faces. Stuart lifted his head, but Sal was slightly below him, choking under the surface. Reaching out in desperation to touch his wife's face, Stuart could do nothing to stop the water pouring into her mouth. Stuart heard his wife drowning until finally she lay silent and still by his side. Above ground, rescuers at first heard some victims screaming for help from under the mud. Rescue services poured into the area, but the landslide site was still unstable underfoot, and police stopped anybody trying to dig in the dark. Firefighter Warwick Kidd knows how notoriously unstable landslide debris can be.
the slope at which we were working, I mean, it was horrendous. It was very hard to stay upright.
Nobody knew if the landslide had stopped or was about to resume its headlong rush down the hill.
There's a very fine line between bravery and foolhardiness. The site is like a big set of pickup sticks. You pick up the wrong stick and the whole thing's going to crash down.
Rescuers worked around the clock, but found no sign of life. But one man was still alive. In his concrete tomb, Stuart Diver was half naked, freezing cold, and barely able to move. Distraught at the loss of his wife, Stuart strained to lift his head above the muddy, polluted water that kept flooding over him. Fifty-three agonizing hours after the slide, a rescuer heard a cry from below his feet. Stuart could be heard through a tiny opening, far too small to free him, but just big enough for a camera to be lowered down. Rescue-trained paramedic Paul Featherstone talked to the trapped man for hours, trying to judge how badly injured he was and reassuring him that help was on its way.
I could monitor him through a little screen, so I had really good communications with Stuart under the ground.
In an emotional bond with his would-be rescuer, Stuart revealed the horror of helplessly hearing his wife die.
He'd been through absolute torture and hell, really. He'd lost the love of his life. He's feeling physical pain and mental anguish like none of us could imagine.
For 12 hours, rescuers dug their way inch by inch toward the trapped man. The noise of digging and concrete cutting machinery was deafening. Every time the earth started slipping, the rescuers had to evacuate, and then the site fell silent. While others left, Featherstone refused to abandon his trapped patient. He even came up with a plan to explain the silence.
What we had to do was try and fool him or convince him that, you know, things were all right up top. Because I knew he'd be now not hearing anybody working above him, I picked up a shovel and I started belting it on the rocks as though other people were still working.
Eventually, Stuart was pulled alive and almost uninjured from the wreckage. His miracle rescue lifted the spirits of Australians who had been stunned by the tragedy. And just a few days later, still deeply traumatized by the loss of his wife, Stuart sent a message from his hospital bed.
All the people who have prayed for me and given me so much support over the last couple of days, it's been overwhelming and I don't think I would have made it through.
The cause of the Threadbow landslide at first mystified geologists. Water was clearly involved, as evidenced by Sal and Stuart Diver's ordeal. Yet there had been no rain for days, and it was too early in the season for snow to be melting from the mountain. So where had the water come from? Months of inquiry finally isolated unusual and entirely man-made causes of this disaster. A water pipe running above the village had leaked and saturated the soil. And the geologists also found that this part of the village, now a memorial park for 19 victims, had all been built on unstable debris from a landslide hundreds of years before. This disaster could have been prevented. Humans playing a part in landslide disasters is nothing new. In 1963, 2,000 people died in Italy when landslides displaced a massive flood from the newly built Vaillant Reservoir. 3 years later, 144 children and adults were buried alive when a man-made mountain of coal slag collapsed onto a school at Aberfan in Wales. Such disasters are terrifying, but there are other landslides even more destructive. A flow known as a lahar, a torrent of rock, mud, and debris, rushing like a river downhill at speeds of up to 90 miles an hour. Unstoppable, inescapable, and deadly. One sort of landslide travels faster than any other. It's called a lahar, a landslide so wet that it looks and flows like liquid concrete, traveling at up to 90 miles per hour, picking up everything in its path. They can be created in several ways: by volcanic heat rapidly melting snow and ice, by intense rainfall onto loose volcanic soil, or even by the overflow of natural lakes dammed by lava debris in high volcanic craters. The 1980 eruption at Mount St. Helens sent massive lahars speeding down the mountain at more than 70 miles per hour. And in Yunnan Province, China, monsoon rains regularly washed this torrent of rocks and earth along this remote riverbed. It looks like water, but it's actually the world's most spectacular mudflow. In 1995, a visiting American geologist caught the lahar on camera at considerable risk to himself.
This is a big sucker. Here it comes. You'll notice the camera's a little jiggly. God almighty. In fact, I'm going to back up at this very moment. This camera location is not safe. I am leaving right now. Just hit the camera. Still seems to be recording.
New Zealand's largest active cone volcano, Mount Ruapehu, sent a killer lahar downslope in 1953. It smashed into a railway bridge, derailing a passing express train and killing 151 people on board. New Zealand's worst ever rail disaster. And Mount Ruapehu could produce a devastating new lahar at any time. Scientists are closely monitoring the volcano for warning signs of a coming eruption, burying sensors to record any seismic activity on the mountainside. Volcanic debris stops water flowing away from this lake at the top of the volcano. As the lake rises, or if there is another eruption, that natural dam might burst. Cameraman Jeff Mackley is trying to capture the next lahar on film. He is installing a camera system automatically triggered if a lahar should start to slide. Scientists hope that any film he gets will help them better understand the flow of such powerful lahars. In populated areas, lahars can be devastating. But even they cannot compare with one landslide site that threatens destruction on a biblical scale. A slide from this mountain could kill millions of people in Europe and along America's eastern seaboard. Some eminent scientists warn that it's purely a matter of time till it happens. This is the volcanic island of La Palma, 700 miles off the northwest coast of Africa. It's a newborn baby island, barely past its 4 millionth birthday, created in the last stage of what geologists call the rock cycle. Volcanoes can form land in various ways. In Hawaii, lava gently pours from vents in the ground to build up almost horizontal layers of new rock. But elsewhere, as here on La Palma, more violent eruptions build steep-sided cones with surrounding layers of thick ash. Eruptions in the past 60 years have jolted this island to the core, creating a fault line, a crack you can walk through, along the island's central spine, 6,000 feet above the Atlantic Ocean. On the western side of the fault, the land fell 13 feet down, then stopped. Geologist Bill McGuire and other scientists say gas pressures could build up in a future eruption and crack open the island along this fault line. They have traced the fault for at least 9 miles along the island ridge. And they believe the fault is so long that when it cracks open, 500 billion tons of rock will slide thousands of feet down into the ocean.
So it's going to go during a future eruption, there's no doubt about that. The problem is eruptions occur sometimes every 20 years, sometimes every 200 years.
McGuire paints a terrifying fantasy picture of what anyone standing on the top of the landslide would see and hear.
I don't know if anybody's heard the noise made by this amount of rock sliding against another great chunk of rock, but I always imagine it as if there are a million fingers scraping down a blackboard.
The slide will reach a speed of more than 220 miles per hour.
So you'd be hurtling down the slope of the volcano. It would start to break up into smaller pieces as it entered the ocean. But by then, it would already have displaced something like half a mile of water, which would be towering above your head. And that would be probably the last thing you'd ever see. Spectacular way to die.
McGuire believes the impact with the ocean will create a dome of water nearly 3,000 feet high.
This is a mass of rock which is probably bigger than Manhattan Island. And when it collapses, it will generate ocean-wide tsunami, which will be at least as devastating as those that struck the Indian Ocean.
The vast amount of energy pumped into the ocean will create what one scientist has called a mega tsunami. Tsunami waves racing out in all directions. Computer predictions suggest they could even travel 4,000 miles toward the eastern seaboard of the United States, losing some, but not all of their power along the way.
That wave will travel all the way across the Atlantic Ocean to the east coast of North America. But the water itself won't move all the way across. The individual particles in the water will transmit the energy to one another. And we can demonstrate that quite nicely on a pool table here, where the energy from this first ball I'm going to hit is transmitted through all the others to the last one.
Just as energy moves from ball to ball, so the landslide energy transfers from water particle to water particle across the ocean. As the landslide's energy approaches the coast, it builds up into a massive wall of water. These deep reds and blues are computer predictions of waves 100 feet high and more.
The level of destruction is difficult to quantify. It is going to be enormous, there's no doubt about that. If people are still in the cities when the collapse occurs, you may be considering millions of casualties.
You can see lava flows. But other equally eminent scientists hotly dispute McGuire's warnings of potential disaster. One of those disaster skeptics is oceanographer Russell Wynn. He believes a crucial factor is how long the fault is in the island's spine. All of the scientists agree that the longer the crack, the more of the mountain could break off and slide into the ocean. And Wynn disputes his scientific rival's claim that the crack is long enough to pose a realistic and imminent threat.
We just don't have enough knowledge at the moment to say that with confidence. That's too big a step to be able to make at the present time.
Wynn thinks that the crack along the western flank is shorter than McGuire's team has suggested.
A Okay, April, I want to line you up with the fault, so can you take several paces to the east? Okay.
On some parts of the route, the fault is hard to identify clearly.
Okay,
so Wynn's team act as markers along the very edge of a volcanic crater, tracing out points along the fault.
I'm standing on top of the fault, and it's running right down beneath me to where Terry is standing.
I can see the fault, and I can trace it through here towards April. And I can follow the fault below me, where it displaces a pebbly layer about 5 feet towards the west.
Okay, thanks, guys. That's fantastic. I'm lining you all up with the compass, and it looks like we've got a north-south oriented fault system.
There is a fault there. We can map it with confidence for several hundred yards, but to start saying we've definitely got a fault that's several miles long, I think that itself is a controversial piece of science.
Wynn's colleagues have taken 3D sonar images and core samples of underwater debris flows from previous landslides in these islands. Their evidence suggests such slides don't happen in one gigantic crash, but in several smaller stages. Back on the La Palma volcano, Wynn demonstrates how stage landslides can happen.
Right now I'm standing on a landslide 400 feet above this great big crater, and it's an interesting landslide because it looks like it's happened in several stages. So this block that I'm standing on will have failed, which would then have been followed by this block that I'm now standing on. And then if I continue walking up and come up to this point here, this piece of ground hasn't actually failed yet, but one day in the future, that will also develop into a landslide.
If Wynn is correct, then a series of small landslides could never trigger the catastrophe that some have predicted.
Understanding how these landslides fail is really important. If that landslide occurs in several stages, then you might get several smaller tsunamis, but not a big mega tsunami.
It may sound like an academic dispute, but the size of the landslide tsunami would mean the difference between life or death for millions of people. And McGuire and his colleagues still stand by their warnings of potential disaster.
The idea that this giant landslide will break up into small bits before it slides into the North Atlantic is truly wishful thinking.
McGuire's team are now developing a satellite-based radar system to monitor movements along the landslide site.
We don't know when this is going to happen. The probability in any one year, however, is the same. So it's just as likely to happen this year as it is in 1,000 years' time.
Next, Naked Science looks at research where scientists do all agree, at their efforts to protect us from slides and flows, and even from massive rocks falling from on high. Gravity drags all land inexorably downwards, sometimes with dramatic results. Because of the danger, scientists constantly seek ways to protect us from landslides. As here at the United States Geological Survey Landslide Laboratory in Oregon. 40-ton landslides cascade down a 30-degree, 310-feet-long concrete flume. 18 sensors set into the floor of the chute gather data about the landslide's speed, the way it flows, and how individual particles slide and collide with each other. These artificially generated events help scientists measure the power, speed, and reach of a debris flow landslide. Scientists can vary how much water is present and what sort of rock is going to slide. Water is sprayed onto some of the sediment until a landslide is created. This research helps design slide protection systems, solid walls to divert or stop the flow, or flexible netting to absorb their awesome power. But although nets may divert a debris flow, it's a lot harder when it comes to stopping a falling rock. Scientists in Switzerland offer a vivid demonstration of just how dangerous a falling rock can be. No contest. 176-pound rock, 1, car, 0. The car destruction makes an important point. Roads and train tracks are always at risk in mountain areas. Scientists here test the efficiency of lightweight protection netting. They drop rocks ranging from 2.5 tons to just a few pounds. Today's test involves an 800 kilogram weight. That's almost a ton, 10 times heavier than the rock that destroyed the car, and falling from the same 90 feet height. That weight is exactly half the maximum weight that this particular net is designed to withstand. To pass its test, the net must stop the rock's fall and descend downwards by no more than 15 feet. This net has passed its test. How did it withstand the enormous kinetic energy of the falling weight? Step one is the net itself. The interlocking steel rings spread the load widely, and each ring is made of individual wire strands to increase the overall strength. The net moves freely on its cables, like drapes from a curtain rail, with the movement absorbing some of the impact. Finally, the cables are anchored on solid metal rings, designed to stretch and distort on impact. It's similar to the energy absorption principles employed in car crumple zones, which distort to protect the driver. And most of the time, it works. Continued research means the nets get lighter and lighter, but withstand heavier and heavier rockfalls. These systems are getting better at taming the power of gravity. A power that some people still insist on challenging.
People want to live where it's beautiful. Unfortunately, scenic beauty also comes at a very steep price.
At La Conchita, for example, some townsfolk are already rebuilding their homes. Telling California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger that despite the danger, they will continue living in the shadow of these hills.
Thank you. 10 years ago, when this happened, we refused to leave. We refuse to leave now.
The desire for a home near such dangerous hills baffles California geologist Bruce Perry.
I have mixed emotions about the community of La Conchita. I really can't help but question the sanity of people who decide to ignore the obvious danger in living in such a beautiful but dangerous place. Gravity will have an effect. Gravity will pull those slopes down in the future. You can count on it.
But gravity is just one factor in our detective mystery of what causes landslides. Nature's rock-building skills leave much to be desired, and human errors contribute to disasters such as the landslide that killed Stuart Diver's wife. And then there is water. Water from rainstorms. Water in the freeze-thaw cycle of Yosemite's peaks. Water leaking from water pipes. And even water building steam pressure inside a volcano.
Water really is the nemesis of slopes. Water is what causes slopes to be destabilized and to begin to move.
Always at the scene of the crime. Water is the ever-present culprit that causes landslides. Science tries to help, but nothing can withstand a major slide's awesome power. They remain a deadly threat to our safety, as long as we choose to live in the shadow of landslide-prone slopes.